It's getting there.
There you go.
There we go.
Rosio Lumos.
That was fantastic. That was very well done.
Now this, but before we start, I should begin properly with the story of Harry Potter. Now, not the one you all know, that's hopefully why you're all here, but the one of how J.K. Rowling actually created the series. This story starts almost three decades ago in 1990. It doesn't begin in Edinburgh either, but on a train stuck between Manchester and London. Mm-hmm. The young Joanne Rowling was returning home from her job as a secretary when her train was delayed, and she was left staring out her window at a very uninspiring sight, simply a large field speckled with some cows, when the idea of Harry Potter popped, fully formed, into her mind. A year later, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone was finished. Or Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, if, as I'm told, you're apparently wrong. By any chance, I like the enthusiasm. Does anyone know why the name was changed to the Sorcerer's Stone in the United States?
Yeah.
It sounds better, that's true. The real reason is actually a lot more cruel than that. To use their official wording, publishers thought that the idea of a philosopher was too intellectually demanding for American children, which is a massively offensive decision, I think, in front of the final resting place of a man named William McGonagall. Of course, you'll all be familiar with Professor Minerva McGonagall, the no-nonsense deputy headmistress at Hogwarts. J.K. Rowling has confirmed in an interview that William was the inspiration for Professor McGonagall's name for its School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. Now, it was built in 1628 at the request of Royal Goldsmith George Heriot himself. Now, thank you for volunteering. Unfortunately, you can kind of see the Sorting Hat has lost a bit of its magic since I stole it from Hogwarts. You can take a wild guess as to which house I'm in. I can't speak anymore, but with me being a witch, I should be able to translate it all very nicely. If you were at George Heriot, which house would you want to be sorted into? They've got Castle, Lauriston, Rayburn, or Greyfriars?
Castle.
If you were at Hogwarts, that would put you in Ravenclaw. Are you happy with that?
Yes.
It matches the coat as well. That's great. Well, congratulations. Thank you. Can we get another round of applause for our lovely, great volunteer? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
There is one more building in Edinburgh that's said to have contributed to the Hogwarts design, and that is, of course, the Edinburgh Castle. We've got a lovely view of it just there, which is a military show that takes place every day in August. Now, it does look, conveniently, very much like a Quidditch pitch when it's fully set up. It's got big flags that billow in the breeze, and it actually would have been what J.K. Rowling would have seen from her seat in the Elephant House. Now, interestingly enough, depending on where exactly she was sat in the Elephant House, she had a clear view of either the George Heriot School or the castle, so it's my thinking that both kind of played an equally important role. Now, there even used to be a massive lake outside the castle about 200 years ago. It was called the Narluk, and it's where the Princes Street Gardens are now. Now, I'm sure you've all guessed that there isn't someone actually buried here named Lord Voldemort, but this is the grave of a man named Thomas Riddle. You remember, of course, that Tom Riddle is Lord Voldemort's real name. Now, looking closely, you'll see that the spelling of the last name has been changed in the novels. Can anyone take a guess as to why?
To make it spell out, I am Lord Voldemort?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. It was to allow for the anagram, I am Lord Voldemort. Now, interestingly enough, depending on what language you read the books in, the full name of Tom Marvolo Riddle is translated into different things to allow for that same anagram. For example, if you read the books in French, Tom Marvolo Riddle then becomes Tom Elvis Jeudissor. Elvis, because he's a very groovy man, apparently. There's a theory as well that Voldemort has some French roots, because J.K. Rowling liked to combine different words to make new ones. Excuse me. Voldemort could then be the result of the word volonté, which means a person's will, and mort, which means death. But if you translate Voldemort as a whole, it also means flight of death, which is very fitting to the whole theme of the books. Now, apparently as well, if you read the books in Mandarin, those characters do not allow for anagrams, so they put the name Tom Marvolo Riddle in English, and then there's an asterisk that leads to a footnote that explains the joke.
Oh, wow.
By people on the tour as well.
Helpful.
Everyone can get our wands out and kind of get the spell ready. It is Rosio Lumos. We're going to say it together on three. One, two, three.
Rosio Lumos.
Fantastic. At the Spoon Bistro, the big white one on top, that is the real location of where the first Harry Potter book was written. Many people believe it to be the Elephant House, but I will get back to that in a little bit. Now, the big building just beneath it is actually called the Balmoral Hotel. If the Nicholson Cafe is where Harry Potter began, then the Balmoral is where it ended. J.K. Rowling finished writing Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows in room 552 and marked the event with an act of vandalism. She took a marble bust of Hermes from her room and wrote underneath in Sharpie, J.K. Rowling finished writing Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows in this room on the 11th of January, 2007. A very long-form version of J.K. Rowling was here, essentially. But instead of pressing charges, the hotel took this bust and placed it inside a glass box, swapped out the brass knocker on the door for a brass owl, and renamed room 552 the J.K. Rowling Suite. You can now stay there for a mere £1,195 a night.
Oh, decent.
I've heard, however, that breakfast is included, so that is a bonus. Oh. At this point as well, I normally get the question, does J.K. Rowling still live in Edinburgh? And the answer is actually yes. Huh. At least one of her main homes is here.
Yeah.
It's in a suburb area called Barnton. This house is, of course, a massive turreted mansion. And there's a rumor as well that she bought the house next door to acquire a bit more land in order to build a massive Hogwarts-style treehouse for her kids.
Oh,
a dream come
so
true for
cute.
People of all ages, I really believe. I would love that now. It would be fantastic. Here's to Diagon Alley. In reality, this is Victoria Street. It's a big winding road just behind me. There is, of course, debate amongst Harry Potter fans as to which street in the entire UK is the real inspiration for Diagon Alley. There is Cecil's Court in London, the Shambles in York, and Coburn Street, which is also here in Edinburgh, but on the other side of the Royal Mile. We at the Potter Trail, however, believe Victoria Street to be the real deal because it's got all the same signs and characteristics as Diagon Alley is described as having in the Harry Potter books. And hopefully you folks have had an incredible time on this tour as well. Thank you so much for bearing with and with the luck of light. Thank you for laughing at my terrible jokes. I'm fully aware that they're terrible, so thank you for that. In a minute, I will be holding out the sorting hat to unfortunately ask for the wands back. My name once more has been Charlotte. It's been a pleasure to have all of you today. If you've enjoyed the tour, we've got a TripAdvisor page, a Facebook, a Twitter. Leave us a review or shoot us a nice message to say you've enjoyed it. If you hated every second of it, my name is Brian, and I don't know what Harry Potter is, so just don't Google it. Enjoy the rest of your day, and thank you so much.
Woo! I was trying to clap.
Thank you.